Good morning friends, I'm Srishti Jain and today we are going to do another set of 5 questions of finance. So today we are going to discuss the topics related to the loanable funds. Then we have a scheme, Ek Bharat, Shreshth Bharat. Then we are going to discuss the concept of financial dualism, which is very interesting. Next we are going to discuss the recommendations of the Concurrent audit system. And the last one is the think tank on the framework for national policy on e-commerce. I hope that you will like my video. Do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. Now starting with the first question for today. The question says the market for loanable funds consists of arrangements and procedures to carry out transactions between people who want to borrow money and people who want to lend money. The loanable funds theory of interest is also known as. Now with this statement, it is very clear that the loanable funds is regarding the borrowers and the suppliers of the money, or the loanable funds as described here. So this theory is also known as the neoclassical theory of interest. We are going to discuss this neoclassical theory of interest in the next slide, and also in brief we are going to compare that what is the difference between neoclassical theory, classical theory, Keynesian theory and the modern theory of interest. So do pay the attention now. So loanable funds theory says it is the determination of interest in terms of demand and supply of the loanable funds. So interest rates are determined. So here we have the loanable funds. Here we have the rate of interest. And demand curve is downward sloping, whereas the supply curve is upward sloping. The intersection between this is the determined rate of interest for OQ level of loanable funds. Now here, the demand is done by the government, businessmen, consumers. Supply is done by private savings, individual savings and the corporate savings. So this is about the neoclassical theory. Now one thing to note here is that why this demand curve is downward sloping. Now it slopes downward, showing that less funds are borrowed at a higher rate and more at a lower rate of interest. Whereas this is the opposite in case of supply. This is the very basic thing you must have read in your economics. Now talking about the classical theory, then what is the difference between neoclassical and classical theory in terms of the demand and supply of the loanable funds? So in the classical theory of interest, the demand is done by, now in the classical theory of interest, the demand for capital is a demand for investment, which is influenced by the marginal productivity of capital. Whereas if we talk about supply, then the supply of capital comes from saving, which depends on the willingness and power to save. Then we have the Keynesian theory of interest. Here, if we talk about the demand side of loanable funds, then the demand for money means the demand for liquidity, or the demand to hold money in cash for the transactions motive, precautionary motive and the speculative motive. Whereas if we talk about the supply side, then the supply of money is fixed and controlled by the monetary authority and it is perfectly interest inelastic. Now, the modern theory of interest talks about the ISLM curve. LM here is the money market, whereas IS is the investment and savings market. So first classical theory came, then the improvement was done in the neoclassical theory, then the improvement was done in the Keynesian theory, and lastly the modern theory of interest. So the answer to this question is the neoclassical theory of interest. Now moving on to the next question for today. Ek Bharat, Shreshth Bharat program is launched to promote the spirit of national integration through a deep and structured engagement between which of the following two categories to strengthen the emotional bonds between the people of India? So the correct answer to this question is states and union territories. So this program is not yet known by many of the people. And as a result, our Prime Minister Modi has decided to high visibility campaign similar to the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Now let's talk about what Ek Bharat Shreshth Bharat means. Now we all know that India is a unique nation, a mix of every religion, culture, so there is a diversity. So in order to have a cultural connect between the different regions, Prime Minister Narendra Modi during Rashtriya Ekta Divas held on 31st October 2015 on the birth anniversary of Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel. He introduced this Ek Bharat Shreshth Bharat program. Now, what are the objectives? First is to celebrate. To celebrate the unity and diversity of our nation. Second is to promote the spirit of national integration through a deep and structured engagement between all the states and union territories through a year-long planned engagement between the states. Third is to showcase the rich heritage and culture, customs and traditions of either the state for enabling people to understand and appreciate the diversity that is India, thus fostering a sense of common identity. Fourth is to establish long-term engagements. And lastly, to create an environment which promotes learning between states by sharing best practices and experiences. Now, the nodal ministry for the coordination of this program is the Ministry of HRD, that is Human Resource Development. Now, what happens here is, let's see. For example, in 2017, Andhra Pradesh was paired with Punjab. So during the year 2017, Punjabis would attempt to learn keywords in Telugu. A few Telugu books would be translated into Punjabi and vice versa. Andhrites would hold food festivals offering Punjabi dishes. Punjabis would perform Andhra folk dances. So this pattern of cultural adoption of the partner state or the union territory would be followed by all the states and union territories. Now, let's move on to the next question after having a discussion on this program, which is really an interesting one, to save our culture, to have a mutual understanding amidst the shared history and a spatial unity in diversity. Now, moving on to the next question. So this question is, what do you mean by the concept of financial dualism? So firstly, let me tell you what financial dualism means. It means when in a country there is a coexistence of unorganized and the organized sectors of financial markets, that is informal and the formal financial markets. So this kind of structure is usually present in the least developed nations. So if you will search this financial dualism on internet, you will find that it is the coexistence of organized and unorganized money market in least developed countries. But if we look at the logic behind it, that is, it is the coexistence of the organized and unorganized financial markets. And as we know that India is a developing country, and we can find over-the-counter markets, which is a kind of unorganized market. So the correct answer as per the logic would be the coexistence of organized and unorganized financial markets in the developing countries. So this is the wholesome definition which I think is fit for the term financial dualism, as it contains the basic logic behind the word. Now, moving on to the next question for today. RBI has constituted an expert committee to look into the entire gamut of issues relating to classification of bad loans, effectiveness of audits, and rising incidence of frauds. Recently, under whose chairmanship RBI revised the guidelines on concurrent audit system? So the correct answer to this question is A, that is YH Malegam. Now let's look at the recommendations, or we say the revised recommendations on this in the next slide. In September 2019, following the recommendations of an expert committee, as I have already told you, which is headed by YH Malegam, Reserve Bank of India has revised the guidelines on the concurrent audit system. Now, what concurrent audit means? It is a systematic and the timely examination of the financial transactions on a regular basis to ensure accuracy, authenticity, compliance with the procedures and guidelines. So now let's see what are the revised recommendations by RBI. First is related to tenure. So as per the new guideline, concurrent auditors will be appointed for a period of not more than 3 years, as against the earlier tenure of 5 years. Second is coverage. The detailed purview of the work for concurrent auditors, coverage of business branches, is left to the discretion of the internal audit head of banks with the prior approval of the audit committee of the board of directors. Then we have the appointment of auditors. So the banks having the option of selecting whether concurrent audit should be done by the bank's own staff or the external auditors will remain to be left to the discretion of individual banks. They should be experienced, well-trained and sufficiently senior person. They must be independent of the branch or the business unit in which they are doing audit. Now, we have accountability. The appointment will be cancelled if any serious acts of omission or commissions are noticed in the concurrent auditor's work. And all the banks should frame a policy for fixing the accountability in these cases. The next is about remuneration. Now, the audit committee of the board of directors of the bank will decide the remunerations, which is to be paid to external concurrent auditors. So these are some of the guidelines issued by RBI with respect to the concurrent audit system following the recommendations of the committee headed by YH Malegam. Now moving on to the next question for today. Who chaired the first meeting of the think tank on the framework for national policy on e-commerce? So the answer here is D, that is Suresh Prabhu. Now let's have some brief discussion on this national policy on e-commerce as well. So Suresh Prabhu is the Minister of Commerce and Industry and Civil Aviation, and he chaired the first meeting of the think tank on the framework for national policy on e-commerce, and its first meeting was held on 24th April 2018. So this think tank is established by the Department of Commerce. Now what is the key outcome of this first meeting? That is to constitute a task force for preparing recommendations for India's national policy on e-commerce. And the task force will be divided into various subgroups comprising representation from the government of India, e-commerce industry, and experts with domain knowledge. So what was the main focus of this think tank? It focused on the challenges confronting India in the arena of the digital economy and e-commerce with a view to developing a comprehensive national policy on e-commerce. So if I talk about some of the challenges here, then it may be the taxation policy, digital infrastructure, FDI, technology flows. Now, with this, we have completed our 5 questions of finance for today. I hope that you like the session. So do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. And if you have any query related to any of the concept, then do not hesitate to comment in the comment section below. Thank you for watching the video.